Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Hammer Podcast. But before I begin, make sure to hit that subscribe button to help grow this channel. It is greatly appreciated. Today is May 9th, 2020, and we're going to be talking about transcending poverty and moving forward. Our guest today is Dan Harrison. And if there is anyone who is interested in this subject and would like to come on the podcast and have a discussion with Dan about it, then text your name, it can be real or anonymous, to the number in the description, and we'll set up a time to have you come on the podcast and talk to Dan. Now, I want to remind everybody that this is a free and open discussion, so you can speak your mind, but please keep it civil. So enjoy the podcast, and please comment below.
I don't have a great deal of academic qualifications to be talking about this. I've never held an elective office, been in charge of a government welfare agency or anything like that. What I have is common sense and the ability to speak the truth, which is rare, unfortunately, and it's what's really missing in arguments about poverty and social justice and that sort of thing. So that's what I have to contribute, and I would hope that the listeners would listen with an open mind, really weigh these things, and if I'm full of it, you can tell me I'm full of it. By the way, I'll throw out the challenge. If anyone from a contrary point of view, Jason, I know you encourage free speech and good debate, so if anyone wants to come on and we can do a threesome and have a three-way conversation, if someone wants to present a different side, I'll be glad to articulate these in the presence of someone arguing a different point of view. Happy to do that.
Right. Okay. Sure.
So they'll be able to contact you through the YouTube, and then we can set that up.
They can, yes, there's like three or four different ways they can get a hold of me. So, okay. Yes, if I'm sure that this is going to get a lot of comments in the comments section, so we'll be able to see what they comment, and then I'll, you know, reply and say, hey, if you want to come on and voice your point of view, I'll let you know, and then we can have a three-way conversation that way.
Yeah. Yeah,
okay.
That would be useful, yeah.
All right. Now, it says the first point here, what is your definition of poverty, and what is the government's definition?
Okay. The government has a definition of the poverty lines, and they're plural. They're not always well understood. It's a different line depending on how many people in your family. So, for example, a single person, the poverty line right now is about $12,000 per year. A family of four, it's about $25,000. And that applies across the country, even though there are different costs of living. So it applies in, you know, Manhattan and San Francisco, where it's a very high cost of living. It also applies in Brownsville, Texas, where it's very low cost of living. So for that reason, it's more, they use that to divvy up the money, but it's not really a very effective definition of poverty. My definition of poverty is a state of mind. It's a state of mind where you're not being grateful for what you have, and you think whatever you have is not enough. And it doesn't really matter what's in your bank account. I would point out that Jesus and the Prophet Muhammad were both poor, but they had prosperity consciousness. And I would also point out, if anyone wants a chuckle, go to your internet search engine and type in the search term lottery winners. And you'll see hundreds of stories about thousands of people who have won $10 million or $20 million in the lottery, and within a couple of years, they're broke. They obviously have a poverty consciousness. So it doesn't have to do with how much you're making, and it has to do with how careful you are with your money and how grateful you are.
Okay, well, I found the definition, the government definition of poverty, and... let me give you mine. I think it's basically you're living without the necessities, such as food and clothing and that kind of stuff. I believe that money is a big deal when it comes to trying to get out of poverty, and this is the reason why, because you can't live without it now. I mean, you have to have money to survive. You have to have money to buy things. If you're sick, you need to go to the hospital, you have to pay for that, so you need money. I know I've heard some people say, you know, like, money's not everything. Well, I want to see you live without it. You can't. Yeah. It's not like you're out in the wilderness in a tent somewhere just living off the land. It's not like that, especially if you're in the big city.
Yeah, grease is not everything either, but if you try to run your car without it, you don't get even a mile down the road. So.
That's true. You know, that's true.
Money's the grease that makes life easy.
But and, of course, like I said, the definition for the government is, let's see, I have it right here. Yes, it's individual with income less than $34 a day or a family of four with less than $69 a day of income. That's their definition of poverty.
Okay.
That's, what's that, from 1980? I mean, that's pretty low.
So, let's see, 69 times 365. That's actually the current definition, because that comes out to $25,000 a year for a family of four, which is their poverty threshold. So yeah,
right.
It's not easy to live on the poverty line.
No, it's not at all.
Yeah.
I mean, $34 a day for a single person. That you can't even. I mean, all you'd be able to buy is food. What about rent? I mean, rent's going up and up. It's not like plus you got property taxes, you got all other types of things. You got to have a car.
Okay.
Of course, you got to pay insurance on that. So to live off $34 a day. If you're really frugal and a penny pincher and you know how to do it, I guess you'll be okay.
Well, I've lived below the poverty threshold, and it's not easy. I had to make tough decisions. It can be done. One has to be very careful with one's money. What I see a lot of poor people doing, just look at what they spend their money on. Cigarettes, alcohol, fast cars, gambling. The lottery is said to be a tax on poor people. I call it a tax on stupid people, because for every dollar you put in, you're going to get, on average, 50 cents back. That's not a good investment. And that's mostly, it's skewed heavily towards poor people who do that. So. You can't do those things if you expect to live at the poverty level and survive.
Well, most of the neighborhoods that have people living in poverty, like I said, you have cigarettes, alcohol, drugs, prostitution, all that kind of stuff. So they basically, like you said, there's addiction, so they have to spend it on other things instead of saving it or being. Or investing it or something like that.
Yeah. I'm not here to defend companies that put addiction-based products within easy reach of poor people. I think that's unethical, and I don't support it at all. At the same time, they're going to do that. That's what people like that do. And so, beating up on them verbally is not really going to solve anything. And we need to look at how do we get people out of those addiction cycles. So that's what we need to look at.
Well, how to get them out of the cycle, usually when they're in that type of mindset and they've been in that mindset for a while, it's tough to get them out of that. I mean, they do have programs out there. They have the welfare system.
Mm-hmm.
And for me... My problem with the welfare system is too many people are on it for too long. I mean, when I was a kid, yes, we grew up in poverty. I mean, we weren't rich. We weren't, dirt poor, but we had the essentials. You know, we didn't have nice cars or, anything like that. But I believe that if you're going to get on the welfare system is put there for a reason. You get on the welfare system, you... you get back on your feet, and once you're back on your feet financially, then you get off the welfare system and let somebody else get on it if they're having hard times as well. But most people will just get on it, stay on it, and just tap all that money and spend it on, like you said, drugs, alcohol, everything else.
Yeah. And it's getting harder to stay on it. Bill Clinton made a campaign promise he would reform welfare as we know it, and to an extent he did. Now here's an interesting statistic. This is new to me. I normally like to digest a website before I quote it. This one I just found in doing background research for this particular presentation. It's called federalsafetynet.com, and it's a private person's website. He's an accountant. And these numbers, I can quote them because they jive with what I've seen in the federal budget. He talks about how we spend, the federal government spends almost $750 billion per year on poverty programs. $750 billion, that's about $77,000 per family of four. And keep in mind the poverty threshold for a family of four is about $26,000. So we could, you know, obviously they don't get all that $77,000, but, and that's another problem of government bureaucracy and all that, but we could theoretically just buy people out of poverty with that kind of money, and yet we still have poverty. So clearly there's something wrong. We're spending three times as much money to keep people in poverty as it would take to buy them out of poverty. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure out that's not good return on investment. So we need to start there. I personally don't think throwing money at a problem is really going to solve it. As I said, people win tens of millions of dollars in the lottery and they're broke within a few years, so that obviously doesn't work.
Right.
And if we go back to the history of the welfare state, which was started by Franklin Roosevelt in the 1930s, when they developed welfare itself, giving money to people who don't have enough money to make ends meet, the idea was, as you said, they would use it to lift themselves up and then become productive, and their children would say, you know, I'm never going to live like my parents did. And obviously that didn't work. It created instant welfare dependency and an entitlement mentality, which is a very dangerous addiction. And we also rewarded people for having more babies. The more babies they had, the more money they got. And so I remember, a lot of us have experiences of people on welfare having 6 and 7 and 8 children. Well, that's not healthy.
Right.
They don't have a good start in life if they're born into a welfare family. And I'm not here to bash people who grew up in welfare. Some of them make it out, and kudos to them. But let's be honest, a lot of them don't.
So if I had the power and the gift of 2020 hindsight in 1930s, I would have said, fine, you go on welfare and we'll take care of you. You get your tubes tied and you don't have any more kids. There's no negotiation. If you don't like that, then you don't go on welfare. I think we'd be in a very different world if that were the case. And I'm not particularly enthusiastic about sterilizing people, but frankly, I don't see that we have a lot of choice. I think we're at the point now where it's either we do it consciously and carefully and with appropriate safeguards, or things like coronavirus, starvation, climate change, and other disasters will do it for us. That's kind of where we're at right now.
Well, some people would say, well, you're violating somebody's civil rights if you start talking about sterilizing them. I mean, I don't necessarily agree. I agree to a point. I mean, yes, you have to have certain rights as far as the mother with her reproductive rights, as they call it. But they have to be responsible. I mean, don't just start pumping out kids just to stay on welfare or get more money from welfare. You know what I mean? That's the problem.
That's part of the problem. And let me say, I agree. Like I say, I'm not really enthusiastic about jumping out and sterilizing people against their will. I don't wake up in the morning and think, oh boy, I get to go sterilize someone today. That's not something I look forward to.
Right.
Desperate times call for desperate measures. I live in Chicago, and Chicago's not much different from any other large city. You know, everyone wants to talk about the difference in school spending, for example, how rich kids and poor kids have different experiences in school because of spending. Well, that comes from taxes, which are based on property values. And you take a square mile in the inner city, you've got a lot more kids than you do in the suburbs. And property values are lower. So, you know, that's where that comes from.
if we look at life, nobody wants to talk about, for example, life strategies, which are very different. And, you know,
right.
If you look at how people approach having children in a high-functioning household, it's a very important decision. When, with whom, how many, those are very important decisions. In a low-functioning, they're not even decisions. It's just inevitable you're going to get knocked up. And that needs to change. And I really call these social justice advocates to task, and I'm hoping one of them wants to come on and have a discussion with me. Making speeches about people, about, you know, the government and other vague statements, and not looking at how people are irresponsible in raising, having five kids that they didn't want. And until we have that discussion, nothing's going to change.
Well, you know, they do have clinics, free clinics that you can go and get condoms and that kind of stuff to prevent pregnancy. But I think sometimes people are just too lazy to do it. You know what I mean? It just takes too much time, too much work.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of reasons, and laziness and personal agenda and, you know, egos get involved and things like that. None of which is a very useful excuse, because I think it's a form of child abuse to bring a child into this world that you're not prepared to take care of. Something that is new to me in the last 5 or 10 years that I didn't know before. I thought women just got tricked into getting knocked up by these schmucks. I mean, we're talking about incorrigible drug addicts that are never going to recover, and they managed to become fathers. I mean, you know, what were they thinking? And what I've discovered, I live in an area that has a fair amount of poverty, and I like to listen to people tell their stories.
Uh-huh.
Is that women can't wait to get knocked up by anybody. And so this guy just happens to be the first one that comes along. And so, as I said, I think that's a form of child abuse. If they're not ready to take on the 30-year commitment, they have no business.
Well, it's basically a lifelong commitment. I mean, I have two kids of my own, so I know what you mean. But also, they have to realize that getting knocked up, there could be a chance of disease, HIV, chlamydia, herpes, that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. and that can affect the child as well.
Yeah. There's a right way to be born in this world, and there's a wrong way. And unfortunately, any social demographic you can name, the people on the lower, less desirable end of it have more babies, they have them earlier in life, they spend less time with them, less quality time. And every way down the line, those kids have a disadvantage. So the solution, I'm sorry, we're going to have to start confronting. I think we need precision strikes to go after the individuals who are doing a lot of this damage, running around making babies they don't want. I call it the pump and dump method. You know, they pump out babies they don't want, can't afford, and are not willing to take care of. And they dump them on the public and private infrastructure.
Right.
That's you know, we need to start addressing that, because every charity that you can name, there are people, it ends up being, you're subsidizing people who are, you know, they'll now have more babies. If they can get their food taken care of, that means they can have more babies. And then they dump them on the schools, and they dump them on the child welfare system and hospitals and later courts and prisons.
And some of the time, I'm not going to say all the time, but some to most of the time, the father is not even in the picture.
Yeah.
Because sometimes they don't know who the father is, or there could be six kids from six different fathers.
I've had that experience. In case there are any young women listening, it's just a fact of biology. Young women from the age of about 12 to the age of about 30 are driven by their hormones. And I'm not making that wrong. I'm just stating a fact. And the sad thing is that leads them into situations that is going to get them in trouble. And so you're going to have to confront that. And one of the tools you can use that I counsel young women whenever I get the chance, if this guy wants to go to bed with you, ask him if he's got a spare $250,000 that he's willing to put up as a bond to take care of any unintentional pregnancies. That number, 250,000, is a federal government statistic that a child born today is going to cost its parents about $250,000 from birth through the end of age 17. That does not include prenatal care, does not include college education, which is a requirement now, does not include however long they can hang on after high school, and certainly doesn't include your emotional energy and your time and your other commitments. Just the cash value to do it right is about $250,000. So I actually, I'll be sitting around waiting for the train or something, and if I see a guy who's hitting on a woman and the body language looks like he's going to score, I will go up and I'll ask him, "Pardon me, sir, would you happen to have a spare $250,000 in a bank account?" And it's, don't try this at home. You just can turn violent very easily. So I don't recommend it.
Especially in Chicago.
But I like to get down to what's real. And it jolts them out of their hypnosis and gets the woman to start thinking, yeah, if this guy knocks me up, he can't even spell commitment, let alone make one. And so I'm going to be stuck with the problem. And it jolts them out of their reality. So until we start addressing that issue, don't even talk to me about social justice. Don't even talk to me about how unfair the system is. And I'm not here to defend the system either. I'm just saying there are other causes that we need to start looking at.
And these kids are not mentally capable, so to speak. They're still growing. Their bodies are growing. Their minds are growing. That's why the state or whichever state you live in, they tell you, hey, at this certain age is when they can start having sex or whatever, because their mind is still developing. They're not capable of making of making consent, giving consent to have sex. So, but when you talk to these people, Dan, I mean, do most of them listen and say, you know, you're right? Or do some of them just tell you to screw off and threaten you or anything like that?
Mostly the latter, particularly from the male. But if I can get through to the woman and jolt her out of her hypnosis so she can see, hey, I'm on the verge of making a really poor decision here. If I could do that one time out of 10, I'm happy. That's a pretty good batting average for me, 10% success.
Right.
I keep it formal because formality is likely to induce a formal response, rather than them just getting into a fight mode, which is, doesn't prove anything. So it's been interesting. I've been doing this for a couple of years, and I've done it across the country, and it's gotten me some interesting results and some interesting conversations. And, I hope it's made a difference. I don't know. But let's stay on the issue of young women. And I think young men should heed this advice too. But they're not the ones who are going to change. It's the women who are going to stop them. And that's how we're going to get the change. So we apply the pressure at the point of weakness, which is the women making the right decision. So ask him if he's got a spare $250,000 that he's willing to put up as a bond to cover any in contingencies that might happen. And something that I've experienced, now I'm quite a bit older, and I have women 20 or 30 years younger hitting on me, which sounds like every man's fantasy, but it's actually, those women have two things in common. They got knocked up by someone who left them, and they're tired of living in poverty. So it's, I have to tell them, sorry, honey, you made a bad decision. I'm not going to bail you out. That's not my problem. And that's a hard conversation to have. So young women, you need to be thinking about this and thinking, do I want to have to start hitting on guys 20 and 30 years older than me because I need someone to pay the rent? That's the reality of what happens when you make that decision.
Yeah,
by the way, for those of you who are, parents or aunts and uncles or grandparents of young women, you can have this conversation and you need to have it.
And they have sex education in the schools for a reason also.
They do, and that's controversial also, which is unfortunate. Informed people making informed decisions is one of the best solutions we can make. And sex education has to be part of that. I notice the same people who complain about abortions are also complaining about the education that would prevent them. So I don't have a lot of faith in them either. So this is something common sense people are going to have to step up and stop these extremists on both sides from dominating the conversation. We're going to have to have a conversation about facts, about common sense, and about let's get through this together.
Well, getting back to what you were talking about as when you said the young girls are hitting on you, usually younger girls will think, okay, the guy is however old, he's older, 30 years older or whatever. He's obviously, you know, well off, has a job, has money. You know what I mean? That's usually their mindset. Usually the young guys are just starting off. They don't have any money, so they're not looking for them. They're looking for the older men that are already established, basically.
Okay.
And some guys, some older men will fall for it because they're being led by their dicks. Excuse me. But that's what they're being led by. And some guys won't take the bait.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, if she sees me as a meal ticket, I pretty much call her out on it. I pretty much am never going to do that. I'm just going to leave it at that, I think.
Does it depend on how many children? I mean, if she comes up, she has one child who's probably, let's say, 10 or 12, as opposed to a girl that's 21, 22 and's got five kids. You know what I mean?
Well, obviously that's a very stark difference between those two.
Right.
My standard, a lot of men won't date single mothers. I will date single mothers, but I have two qualifications. Could it have been me? And if it were me, would the man who is the father step up and raise my child the way I'm being asked to step up and raise his? If the answer to those two questions are both yes, then we have a bond between brothers. He's not the enemy. He's not some guy who's just knocking women up and running off. They tried their best. It didn't work out. They went their separate ways. I accept that. I'm not going to judge people.
Right.
But when she got knocked up by a loser, some drug addict or derelict or whatever, forget it. I'm not touching that. I'm not. So that's a painful thing for these women. And so young women, if you want to avoid that pain, just be very careful. And remember, the man who fathers your child sets an approximate upper bound for the quality of men that you can attract into your life thereafter. That's a universal trait among men, at least men of honor. And so you need to think about that in advance.
Right.
And that's what's going to get you through and give you the power to say no. And aunts, uncles, parents, grandparents, make sure you have that conversation with your daughters and granddaughters.
And sometimes, like I said, the parents really don't care. They let their kid run off and do whatever he or she wants. And the only time they start to care is either if the kid's got a disease or is knocked up. That's when the caring begins. Yeah. And by then it's too late.
It's too late. So it's never really too late. You can always turn your life around. And as I mentioned, with each child having $250,000 price tag, don't complain to me that you're living in poverty if you have had four kids and you're not even 30 years old. You know, you're going to have to own that one because that's on you. Those are decisions that people have to make. And as I say, if you look around, you notice people in poor communities tend to get pregnant in their teens and 20s and, God forbid, preteens.
Oh.
People more focused on success tend to wait till their 30s or at least late 20s, and they're in several years into a stable, fulfilling relationship before they think about having kids. And you brought up birth control methods are subsidized by most counties these days, and they are.
Yes.
In the county where I live, it'll cost you about 10 cents a day cost a woman about 10 cents a day for birth control pills. That's the subsidized rate, 10 cents a day. So.
And I believe there are also some, you know, clubs, you know, places that you go out and party. They also have little jars or bowls where you can also get condoms there. So it's available.
Yeah.
You know, but they just they just the excuse they're always using for, or what I've heard, is you just don't get the same feeling with a condom as if it was without one. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So, but that's the excuse they use, and then all of a sudden the girl's knocked up, and maybe you should have used one.
let me give you my two bits worth on that whole thing.
Sure, go
first
ahead.
First of all, the overall topic of condoms. If they're used correctly, condoms are about 98% effective on an annual basis. What that means is that if 100 couples who are active use condoms, roughly two of them will get pregnant in a given year. That's better than nothing.
Yeah.
But carry that across a 30-year fertility cycle of a woman, she's got a 60% chance of getting pregnant. That's not a good long-term solution. It's better than nothing, but it'll get you by in a pinch most of the time, but it's not, we have to have higher standards than that. The second thing I will say about the sensitivity issue, yeah, if you're out in bright sunlight and you walk into a dark room, you can't see anything, and your eyes will then adjust and become more sensitive, and over time, you don't notice the difference. So the willpower among certain people to say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to be the ounce of prevention, and that's going to help my long-term prosperity and my partners, and my family will be proud of me. And other people just say, screw it, literally. And that's why we have poverty, and that's why I don't tolerate people bending my ear about social justice and poverty and wage gap and all that, because they're not addressing the issue.
No, they're not. They're feeling sorry for them. I mean, it could have been, it was their fault, but we still have to feel sorry for them and try and help them as best we can. But if they don't want to help themselves, is it a cause that we should be going after?
Yeah, if you look at the last century of poverty programs, they're basically, the metaphor I use is, if you have a problem with overcrowded rabbit hutches and your solution is to build more rabbit hutches, pretty soon you have a bigger problem. And that's kind of what our poverty programs have done, because nobody has the guts to stand up and say, your problem is you're having too many children and you're having them too early in life, and you need to fix that. And we can help you fix it, but until you fix that, don't stand here with your hand out. And that's what nobody's been saying, and that's why over the long term they haven't worked.
Yep, I agree. So, I agree totally. Yeah. Now, the third question that you put on here, Dan, why is it more important than ever to empower poor people to get out of poverty?
Okay. We're at a point with this COVID virus that people are starting to look at long-term stability. And what happens is, people in good times, they make babies. And then in hard times, they stand with their hand out looking for assistance. And I don't think the 21st century is going to be like the 20th century. The last 75 years, in relative terms, have been a fair amount of peace and prosperity, at least in the United States. Now, obviously that hasn't been distributed and it's not consistent and all that. But generally speaking, in a world context, we've had a pretty good life the last 75 years since the end of World War II. Going forward, we're going to be looking at climate change. 5 million Syrian refugees overflooded Europe. When we have 1 billion climate refugees, it's going to overflood the world. And so we're not ready for that. And people need to start thinking, yeah, I need to get my own act together, have my own money in the bank, have my own stash of supplies in case the supermarkets close, and be prepared. And then I can start thinking about starting a family. That's the intelligent way to go. And I'm sorry, but people who don't do that are going to find themselves in dire straits. That's a fact. That's just a fact of life. And we need to stop pretending that it's Donald Trump's fault, or it's Ronald Reagan's fault, or Bill Gates, or whatever. And I'm not here to defend those people. I don't like the system any more than anyone else. But until we start addressing the supply side, you know, we're gonna still deal with these problems. So
right.
It's critical at this point, now that people are starting to think, you know, there's not always easily accessible food in the supermarket. And there's going forward, there's not always going to be all these things that I've come to depend on. And so we need to remember that don't get spread so thin by having 5 or 6 kids that you depend on easy access to resources, because they're not always going to be there and you're going to find yourself starving. So now's the time to start making some long-term plans and say, yeah, you know, I heard these guys on YouTube and they were talking about planning for the long term and not starting a family till I had the resources to start a family. I think I'm going to go that route. And that will pay huge dividends in the long run.
And education is also the key. You have to have, it's really sad that a lot of these schools now are not teaching these kids finance, economics, you mm-hmm. know, how to pay your bills, how to keep a budget, how to, you know, yeah. save up, you know, they're not teaching them that. So these kids are going into
You're
life
right.
blind. And of yep. course, they emulate what their parents did. And if their parents are poor and don't know what's going or don't know what they're doing, they're going to fall into the same trap.
Yeah, yeah. And the default conditions is we imitate our parents. And we learn about relationships from our parents. If our parents argued constantly, then we argue constantly. If our parents were poor were bad with managing money, then we'll be bad with managing money. That's the default condition. The
yes.
game changer, the wild card, the black swan, whatever you want to call it, that can change that is when you stand up and say, no, I am not going to live the way my parents lived. I am not going to just do the default and assume that I'm poor and the system is against me and all that. I'm going to make a difference. And now, even if you didn't get it in school, and you're right, it's tragic that we're not teaching life skills in school, but even if you didn't get it in school, this is the information age. You go to the library, you can find high-quality information for free. I mean, how cool is that?
Yeah.
You know, we have the United States has a library system that is second to none in the world, and I've traveled around the world. I've never seen anything like it. That is primarily one member of the Old Boys Network. His name was Andrew Carnegie. And most of the libraries in this country were built with money from his foundation. So when you have the personal will to find the information, you can find it, and you can make your life better. I want to touch on, you mentioned finances. I teach a financial awareness class at the local library, and it's geared towards working people because, as you point out, they're missing out on this information, and they think they're always going to be poor, which they will unless they change things. And my challenge to them is, if you're a single person, you can live on $25,000 a year, and anything more than that, you can invest for your financial independence goals. And that shocks people, because people think, a lot of people in that class are making $30,000 or $35,000 a year, and they are barely making ends meet. So we start talking about that. We start talking about, okay, if you go to Starbucks for coffee, that's $5 a day. That's $1,800. That's a life of wealth and a life of poverty. If you invest $1,800, that's enough to retire on. If you start, when people start, actually, I use the example of smoking, because a pack of cigarettes is about $5 a day. And if you smoke a pack a day from 15 to 21, and let's say you have a clone brother or clone sister who invests $5 a day from 15 to 21, and then they stop at 21, and you stop smoking, and the rest of your lives are equal, you're going to reach 65, that person's going to be worth about $750,000, and you're going to be worth zero. So,
you know what
the,
I did?
The numbers don't lie.
What I did was, when my granddaughter was born, I opened up an account at the bank.
Okay.
I just, whenever okay. I can throw in 20, 25, sometimes 10, it just depends. I just keep growing that money. You know, that way she has some sort of support. You know, once she reaches 18, college age or whatever, she can, here's the account, here's the money. I've shown you how to manage it correctly. There you go. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Give them the life skills.
Yeah. And so it's important, and I'm happy to share this. I teach this class for free. I don't make any money off it. And it's just getting the information out to people who need it. And it's been well received. But I do find that some people resist. They're really attached to their poverty. They defend it. They're like, who are you to tell me? Well, I'll tell you who I am. I've lived below the poverty line. You know, I've been houseless. Homeless is a different state of mind. I've never had a state of mind where I didn't belong. I've been houseless, but I've never been homeless for 5 years, in fact. And so it can be done. And as long as you have a mindset that you can't, well, guess what's going to be your reality? I learned this in the military, which is an interesting place because there's really not that much difference in pay between the ranks of enlisted people. And I had people hitting me up for a loan even though they made more money than I did. And they were constantly hitting me up for a loan, and I told them no because I made that mistake once and it took me about 6 months to get my money back. So it's not a matter of how much you're making. It's a matter of what are your addictions. And as I said, I look at what people spend money on, junk food, soda. You know, if gasoline hit $6 a gallon, there would be riots in the streets. And yet people will go out and pay $6 a gallon for carbonated sugar water because it says Pepsi or whatever brand they like. And, you know, the advertising is really interesting. The soft drink companies tell you that if you drink our brand of soft drinks, you know, cool people will show up at your house and start dancing. Well, how often does that reality happen? You know, right. I mean, look at, I'm not making this up, Jason. Look at the commercials. Like, all these beautiful people are dancing. Like, it's implication.
It's party time, you know?
You know, I mean.
Yeah. I get
you. So you have to throw a brick through television. And I don't recommend actually smashing the television because that phosphorus is not good to breathe. But you need to monitor your television machine.
Yeah. Also,
it numbs you out and then hits you with the advertising.
Yeah. Also, not only does the soft drinks, I mean, yeah, it's expensive, but, you know, then you have a whole different set of circumstances. You have childhood obesity. You have diabetes, all this other stuff that can happen from drinking all this sugar and corn syrup and all this other garbage that they're putting in these soft drinks and the food, you know, McDonald's and, you know, a home cooked meal at a house can probably cost you about $2 to $3 a person, let's say, as opposed to going to McDonald's and buying a family of four for $30 to $40. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You also have to look at it that way too.
Yeah. My food budget is about $300 a month. I'm a single man, about $300 a month. I'm a vegetarian. Now you don't have to be a vegetarian, but meat is, you know, if you're eating T-bone steak for every meal, you've got a problem. If you're eating pizza for every meal, you've got a problem. So put that number out there. One person, $300 a month is my food budget, and keep track of your expenses for a month. It'll surprise you where you spend money, and that's a really useful tool in getting a little jolt of reality to get you out of poverty, because people don't realize, well, I just buy one cafe mocha at Starbucks every morning and it's $6, and yeah, I get to flirt with the cute girl, but you know, she doesn't actually come home with me, so what's the point?
Right.
And you start adding that up over time, and you'll see that is huge over the course of a year.
Oh, sure.
In the course of
We know.
As I said, I've had many people who make more money than I do either asking me for financial advice or more often hitting me up for a loan.
Right.
And I tell them, you know, if I give the, you know, the Peace Corps has a motto: if I give you a fish, you eat for a day. If I teach you to fish, you eat for a lifetime. So I'll offer to sit down and talk to them about finances. Most of them are not interested because that requires work and it's painful.
Yes. And like you said with the Starbucks coffee, I mean, you could go and probably, I mean, you're looking at $5 a day, let's say, times 30 days, you're looking at about $150 a month just in coffee.
Yeah.
You could go buy a can of Folgers for probably $6 to $7, and that would probably last you a whole month. All you got to do is just make it yourself. They don't want to. People love convenience now. You know, they want everything just handed to them, and they're just going to shell out the money for it. That's the problem.
So I go over that in the finance class. I talk about, what do you pay for? You pay for convenience. You pay because something is fast. You pay because it's sexy, and or you think it's going to get you laid, which it probably won't. You know, if it's trendy, you'll pay for that. But and you need to train yourself not to pay for those things, because it's generally a false promise. It becomes a cycle. So then you feel like you're out of time. Now you need more convenience, and you'll pay for it.
Right.
Well, if you hadn't gotten that rat race, you wouldn't be out of time. So those are common sense things that we all can do. And what's really inspiring is the people who have come from nothing and made themselves into something. And I will put a plug out there for one book that I recommend, which has been the basis of my finances. It's called Your Money or Your Life. It's written by Joe Dominguez and Vicki Robin.
Okay.
And they have a website. It's called, I think it's the new, I've got it right here. I think it's Financial Integrity. Let me look it up here. If you search for the New Roadmap Foundation, here it is, financialintegrity.org.
Okay.
And
we'll put that in the description below.
So they have a program. Yeah, they have a program where, you know, they say it doesn't matter if you're blue collar or white collar, doesn't matter what your background is, you can achieve financial independence. And I've done it. And the program, what I like about this program, it changes how your brain is wired. You start seeing the true cost of things that you value now, and then you value them less, so you're less addicted. And then you start getting value out of things that are not going to cost you an arm and a leg.
Right.
And, it's a great program. So that's worth checking out. And if that doesn't trip your trigger, find something else that does, because there are plenty of financial gurus and life gurus and life coaches and whatever else is out there.
Right.
And but people have to get out of this victim mentality of, oh, the system did it to me. No, you bought into it, and that's what did it to you. And so that's where, you know, and maybe we'll hear some of these high priests of social justice might want to come on.
Sure.
By the way, Jason, if any of them take us up on it, I'm not a fan of the arguments that are like a verbal version of professional wrestling where we just body slam each other. That's not useful, but let's have a thoughtful exchange of points of view and see which one really delivers results. You know, you want to complain about the system and make vague statements about Donald Trump, fine, but that doesn't make you any richer. And if you do these steps and follow common sense and don't get knocked up, wait to have children with someone that you love, you'll do a lot better in life. That's really what it's all about.
And I also think that a lot of these kids have been duped when it comes to money, and I'll explain that. You know, someone says, okay, you're going to be making $10 an hour. Ooh, that sounds like a lot of money. But when you think about it, once they get their check, let's say the check is $1,000, okay, now you got rent, you got insurance, you got all this other stuff. You got kids to feed, you got yourself to feed. Before you know it, you're looking at your check and now it's $50. So it's like, wow, where did this money go? You know, they don't think about that kind of stuff. They just do it and just screw the consequences, we'll deal with them when they come. So now their credit shot because they're not paying their bills. Their car's getting repoed. They're getting evicted from their homes, all that kind of stuff. And now they're living in mama's basement or whatever.
Yeah.
And you think, well, who did it? Well, you did. It's your fault.
It's a hard reality. And it's a known fact among these companies that provide credit counseling, for example. They know it's a revolving door. They'll wind you up, get you on the good foot, and then you'll be done with them. And they know in a couple years you'll be back in debt. It's an addiction. They don't deal with the addiction, and that's the problem. So, you know, it's a good short-term strategy to get yourself out of free fall, but eventually you're going to have to deal with your addictions. And you know, the species Homo sapiens that we're all members of has cognitive intelligence beyond almost every other species on the planet. So let's use that and let's look around. Look at what successful people are doing and look at what's different about what they do versus what you do. That's just common sense. That's something we're all born with.
And another thing, Dan, that you have to think about, or not you, but the people out there, is the demographics. You know, if you go to, let's say, the rich side of town or the well-off side of town, what are you seeing? You're seeing nice restaurants. You're seeing banks. You're seeing country clubs. You're seeing this kind of stuff. Okay, go to, let's say, the east side of town where the poor section is. What are you seeing? Auto loans. You're seeing liquor stores. You're seeing
strip joints.
All this stuff that is just meant to just strip you of your cash. And, of course, get you in debt. And I've noticed that I live in Northeast Wisconsin. So when I go to the east side, that's what I'm seeing. I'm seeing especially title loans. There's a lot of them.
And it's not fair, and I'm not defending that, but it is the way it is. And the way to get out of it is to have discipline. And the good news about discipline is like a muscle. When you exercise it, your discipline gets stronger and you can resist those temptations better. You've got to get that first rung on the ladder. And what I hope that will motivate people to do it is the reality of this COVID-19 that we're dealing with. People are losing their jobs. They didn't have anything in the bank to begin with, and now they've lost their jobs. And, learn from that mistake and let's go forward and let's start living lean. Let's start cutting out all the things that are fast and convenient and sexy that we paid good money for. And let's start investing in ourselves. Let's start. And when you do that, as I said, it will rewire your brain. I can go to the library and get a book for free and get hours of enjoyment out of that book because my brain is wired for that. I can have sex with a condom and I feel great because my organs are wired for that. When you start doing it, your body will adapt.
Right.
And so, those are things that, but you've got to get that first rung on the ladder and then you can pull yourself up and we can help you. I hope we've given people some good information and some good food for thought here, Jason.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And then from there, we'll put some links in the comment section below.
Yes.
And, let's get through this together. And like I say, I tend to be pretty harsh on the politically correct crowd because I just find them getting in the way. And, they obsess over little things that they can be right about, particularly if they can blame it on a small group of straight white males over 50 with college degrees. And they ignore the big picture. And we're going to have to start looking at the big picture and seeing what people do to themselves to keep themselves in poverty. And one of the things, as I mentioned, is family planning. So,
hear, hear, Dan. That's beautiful.
Okay.
So, you got any last thoughts before we decide to wrap this up?
The 21st century is one of the greatest times in the history of the human race to be alive. For those of us who take advantage of it, there are resources that will give us enjoyment that are free and that are abundant, and we just have to look for them. And once you turn off the feeding trough that you've been feeding at all this time, not you, but people who are in poverty have been feeding at a trough that other people have set up for them. And once they declare their independence of that, there's an abundance of things that you can do that will make your life better. And you can have agency in your life. You can be in control. And you will still get peddled, accosted by people who want you to buy whatever product they're selling, but you'll have the discipline and the ability to resist them. And like I say, once you get that first rung, you'll get stronger and you can lift yourself up. That's the message I have. And let's do this together.
All right. Dan, yeah. This was a wonderful discussion. I really enjoyed
it. I look forward to seeing some of the comments. And my challenge stands. If any of those high priests of political correctness want to come on and say, no, it's really about, whatever their pet peeve of the day is, we can have that discussion. And Jason, I'll send you some links that you can put in the comments section. And let's hope this provides food for thought for people out there.
Right. And if you get any challengers, I will certainly notify you, Dan.
And okay. Sounds good.
We'll have a discussion. We will have irrational discussion. No one's going to be talking over anybody. So, we're just going to keep it calm and inform people. So
there we go.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, Dan.
Okay, buddy.
Thank you very much.
All right, thanks, Jason. All right, bye.
Bye. I want to thank everybody for listening today. If you would like to come on the podcast and talk to Dan about this subject, then text your name, it can be real or anonymous, to the number in the description, and we will set up a time for you to come on the podcast and have a discussion with Dan. Or you could just put your comment in the comment section below. And as always, make sure to subscribe to the channel to keep the channel growing. And if anybody has any other subjects they would like to talk about, then send me a text and we will set up a time for you to come on the podcast. So, for the Hammer Podcast, I'm Jason. Take care of yourselves and take care of each other.